I think Bitcoin's mission is massive. Like, if you look at, so there's a terminology in tech called TAM, Total Addressable Market. So when you build a product or service, how big could it get? For example, like Amazon could get as big as all things sold, right? Which is a huge TAM. So with Bitcoin, the TAM is $250 trillion. Like that, that's its total potential value. It could be because you've got real estate, gold, stocks and bonds, and fiat. Those all represent store of value. And so when people go, oh, it'd be really boring if Bitcoin only did gold, like if it was only digital gold, I'm like, that use case is 30x larger than all the other ones combined. So, I think Bitcoin, blockchain technology is built to build Bitcoin. Bitcoin solves a fundamental problem in society that I think is like an ultimately a human rights issue. And it solves that to the tune of a very, very massive total addressable market. So for me, that is the only thing I'm personally interested in, because I think ensuring that Bitcoin is understood, and that's what I try to do with a lot of my content, is make it digestible, simple to understand. Bitcoin succeeding, I think, is paramount for humankind's freedom. So this is a really important issue for me. I think people can work on other interesting projects in the space, but for me, this is what I personally really care about.
Do me a favor, picture your favorite crypto app or exchange. Got it? Now I have five questions for you. Question number one, does your favorite app or exchange have fiat on and off ramps that do not charge you crazy fees? Question number two, does your app actually help you time your investments with machine learning and algorithms? Question number three, does your app or favorite exchange connect to multiple exchanges to get you best rates, best liquidity, but also mitigate the risk of a central failure of one single order book? Question number four, is your favorite app or exchange Swiss made, but also licensed and regulated in the EU so that you can feel 100% reassured, but also sleep well at night? Question number five, is your favorite app or exchange fully aligned with your principles and values, 100% community-centric and not VC-backed? So if your answer to any of these questions is a no, what are you waiting for? Download the Swissborg Wealth app, join the new era of wealth management, and enjoy the ride. For people out there, can you remind us why Bitcoin and why cryptocurrency is so important as of today?
As the first thing which really reminded us on that was the YouTube purge. You heard about it, like, yeah. YouTube just is able to delete all the channels and we cannot upload content anymore, cannot communicate with the audience. You have a YouTube channel yourself. And me with the MM Crypto team, we were just feeling so bad about that. And it shows that Bitcoin is not only decentralized, not only peer-to-peer, it's also censorship resistant. You can send whenever you want money from A to B. You can store data on it. Like, you have nice secondary solutions and no one can prevent you from doing all of that and taking advantage from all of that. And YouTube is centralized, banking is centralized. And I mean, central banking, it's the word already gives it away. So I think crypto and Bitcoin especially is really here to stay and to disrupt all different kind of industries.
For watch market, people are struggling to buy watches at the moment because nobody is really wanting to sell, and that's keeping the prices quite high. Now, eventually all these luxury goods, they're going to decline. And Bitcoin may get lumped in with that, and that's a big concern of mine. Is Bitcoin a store of value, or is it a speculative asset? That will only be decided at the point when the luxury market start crashing. We've seen it with several large chains in America at this point going bust, the large luxury chains, I forget what they called. But it is something that I guess only time will tell. Is Bitcoin speculative, or is it digital gold? I don't think it's digital gold. I'd much prefer it to be cash, but Again, we talked about this in the previous episode. I'm really not a fan of the Lightning Network. I think it's a terrible solution.
Yeah, remember that. You're really upset. And many people have actually felt the same way recently at Consensus Virtual Conference, where a lot of people were dissing the Lightning Network. But you raised a really good point, Jordan. And I think a lot of people would agree with you saying that it's the current economic conditions, quantitative easing, these economic stimulus packages that could be the real bull run for Bitcoin and not the halving or short-term events like this. As you may know, and this is thanks to one of our community members who shared with this on our Twitter feed, in terms of printing money, the US has printed more in the past 2 months than the entire great financial crisis of 2007 to 2009. In 2 months, it surpassed 2 years of printing. How does that sound to you, Jordan?
Well, not only that, but they offered up $3 trillion of worthless government bonds that the public could buy to essentially loan the government money because they can't print any more money, because at that point you would have hyperinflation, essentially devaluing the nation's currency. Because currently there is a massive demand for dollars throughout the world. I mean, I've got family in Ukraine, I've got family in Russia. Everybody is buying dollars at the moment with their currency because their currency is dying. Like, they're really struggling to maintain the value of their currency. The hryvnia in Ukraine, it has struggled over recent years, and it's just struggling even more now because the lockdown in Ukraine is so intense that, I mean, you're not allowed outside. If you go outside, you get arrested. That's how bad it is there. Well, rather good, because it's working for them, but that's because their healthcare system can't cope with any amount of oversupply of customers, essentially. Also, it's a private healthcare system. It's not a public healthcare system.
Have you heard of the, there's a principle called the self-fulfilling prophecy theory. You know how when too many people are aware of the news, may alter the expected outcome?
Yes.
Do you think the halving will react the way it's been reacting in the past, or because it's become such a mainstream topic, things might change a bit?
So I've been talking about on the channel, halving in itself might be a dangerous event because so many people expect it to pump, which means that there are so many people in the space that are still here. They really have lost all the faith because, you know, we've just been dropping from 14K. Many of them are just here to see, you know, maybe it will pump after the halving. So it's a bit dangerous because many of them will dump if they get disappointed. Yeah. And they might get disappointed quickly also because there are so many people hyping up the halving. I think there are also some bears that might dump into that liquidity. So, I mean, as always, there is, you know, buy the rumor, sell the news.
Yeah.
So there's a good chance that the price will increase before the halving because people are excited. When the halving happens, that is when the bears start dumping, because that is when you see so much liquidity to dump into. So if you want to sell a big position, you don't want to sell it now. You want to wait for buyers to come, for people to FOMO in. Because let's say you have a big position, you want to sell it now, you will actually drive down the price. You will get slippage. So you will not be able to sell at current prices. You will sell some Bitcoin at this price and then it will go down. So you will not be able to liquidate. But if many people are buying, then it's perfect. So look, I think halving itself is a bit dangerous, but a few months after halving, that's when the exciting
when
things.
Yeah.
What do you think is the future of Bitcoin dominance? Will it go up? Will it go down? Let us know your views.
Yeah, absolutely. Bitcoin dominance has been falling. It's been falling steadily for a couple of months now, basically since Bitcoin has flatlined, which has been happening since a little bit before the Bitcoin halving. The price of Bitcoin not moving has meant that altcoins are now able to finally breathe again. And we've seen just massive moves in the altcoin market. And the more that altcoins gain, the more Bitcoin dominance falls. Now, a lot of people are under the false perception that a falling Bitcoin dominance is somehow bad for Bitcoin, but that's absolutely not true. We have to remember that Bitcoin hit its all-time high at the height of an altcoin season. So a falling Bitcoin dominance is actually good for Bitcoin because it means that the entire crypto economy is seeing a lot of activity. And if we know one of Bitcoin's main use cases right now, well, outside of just hodling your Bitcoin, is actually trading Bitcoin. And what do people trade Bitcoin for? We've seen derivatives volumes falling down, so people aren't trading Bitcoin for Bitcoin as much. People are trading Bitcoin for altcoins. And when they get those altcoin gains, they cash it back out into Bitcoin. It becomes this virtuous cycle of people speculating, making money, trading, investing, all this stuff. So I see Bitcoin dominance falling farther, unless of course, this is all caveated on if there is another massive financial crash in the equity markets, I think that'll just send fear again through the crypto markets, and people rush back into either Bitcoin or into cash, and altcoins could be left for speculating in a future time. But right now, if we kind of continue the way we've been continuing, I think Bitcoin dominance will continue to fall and altcoins will continue to make massive, massive gains.
The first thing everybody tells you is a warning, is don't roll your own crypto. But unfortunately, we don't have that luxury because we're inventing the crypto as we go along to make these protocols work. If we don't have a VRF that works, we have to create our own, which means we have to roll our own crypto. You know, we've had to modify elliptic curve stuff for, you know, for key erasure stuff. We've had to modify ED25519 for HD wallets. I mean, this is not normal everyday programming. This is like complex heart surgery on very delicate protocols that if you screw up, you introduce all kinds of attacks like side channel attacks and other things. So you need a special breed of developer who's very elite to be able to do this type of work. People say, oh, well, no, you don't. Well, then, you know, look at all the hacks and flaws and, you know, how many things that have occurred over the last 10 years in our space as a consequence of people not knowing what they're doing. And it's just common sense. You know, when you get sick and you need surgery, do you want your butcher to do that or do you want your surgeon to do that? Why do you trust the surgeon with your life? Because that person spent more than a decade of his life or her life studying to become worthy of that. So similarly, why would you trust an amateur with your privacy, with your identity, with your money, these types of things? You should aspire to say that the system that you're using was built on bedrock. It was built by really smart people who knew what the hell they were doing.
So I think that this run up to 14,000 that we got, that was this premature hype, this front running, and this correction that happened after was the consequence or the reaction to this this overhype. So I think that we have already seen the halving being prematurely priced in and also now corrected. So I think that 2020, I mean, the halving will be the biggest story for sure. It is such a huge thing to see the supply, the newly created supply get cut in half, the stock to flow. And I think that this will further create more and more attention towards Bitcoin as a form of money and make more people aware of this inflation schedule that will eventually reach zero. Like I said, this is the first time in history we've seen something have absolute scarcity. Nothing else in the world has 0% inflation. It's not possible except in the digital world. So it is the first time we've seen something being digitally scarce, absolutely scarce, and the halving will put more attention to this fact.
Every single point that was mentioned maybe in, you know, 2010, 11, 12, they just brought back these old, you know, recycled BS messages. But at the same time, Adam Back, you know, as of today, just mentioned that Bitcoin could go all the way up to 300K, which is interesting because Adam Back is more of a technologist, not really the guy who talks about pricing. $300K, $300,000 seems like a lot, but of course it would depend on devaluing of other currencies. But what is your kind of idea on that? How do you feel about people putting these high price tags on Bitcoin?
I mean, I understand it. I understand the concept of the market cap and the idea of someone really large getting involved. You know, all it's going to really take to see major price movement is like a billionaire to, you know, put all of their assets into Bitcoin. We're going to see big price movement. That's really where we're at. There's a very small percentage of people who are invested, and the more that we grow, I can see it growing larger. You know, it's all speculative. So again, you know, it's going to go up or it's going to go down. And I'm not a technical analyst. I'm not someone who does price predictions. So I was just preface with all that. I'm not someone who necessarily does those things, but I do understand the reasoning as to why people believe that it would grow in the future. I also think that the Goldman Sachs incident was like a little strange in its own nature. I think that email was very emotional. I think that there was a lot of stuff that was written in it that, you know, while maybe being true, isn't untrue of other traditional assets. You know, they said something like it went down like a certain percentage. It's like, okay, but like a lot of things have gone down a certain percentage. What makes Bitcoin not an asset class because of this? I think it was evidently rooted in more than just trying to smash Bitcoin. And hopefully savvy investors, people who are actually interested in finding places to, you know, invest, are going to be able to look past sort of that volatility in the email. But that's my opinion of the email itself.
It's funny because actually after that announcement, Bitcoin surged like $500. So a lot of people would think if a, you know, a trusted institution like Goldman Sachs said something bad, you know, a price would plunge, but people reacted positively and didn't really care, right?
Bitcoin and crypto just fits into my whole world philosophy so much in terms of self-sovereignty, personal freedom, personal responsibility. And so when I found crypto, it just was really the it just makes a lot of sense. And it's a tool that I think we can use to help get closer to the type of world and the type of society that I would actually want to live in.
Yeah, absolutely. So those principles and values is very often what resonates to most people out there. But I'd love to ask you, who are some of the crypto educators that you really like to follow in order to get access to quality content?
Oh, yeah. So, you know, obviously there's like some of the big names that I have loved getting to learn from on YouTube, you know, like Andreas Antonopoulos and people like that. But in terms of like people that really inspired me to want to start making more content and do some more education, Naomi Brockwell was actually someone that I really looked up to and was like, and still do, of course, you know, but just as someone that I'm like, wow, I love what she does. I love the energy she brings, the way she breaks things down. And so I wanted to bring some of that energy and that type of approach to my own content, because I do think there's a lot of just really like heavily technical content in the space that can feel a little overwhelming to newcomers. And so I always try to bring that newcomer perspective into the work that I do. Even if I'm not doing total 101 content, like even if I'm just interviewing someone from a project, I always try to keep that mindset of, you know, what questions would me two, three years ago would have had, like, what would those be, and bring those into the conversation so that it actually feels more approachable to people that are getting into the space.
Right, people who are trading in altcoins or gambling. And gambling's a big business, you know? I mean, that's if you want to gamble, gamble. But you can't, there's no comparison. There's nothing to equate the two. Be like equating gold with the number 7 on a roulette wheel at Caesar's Palace, right? One is money, one is gambling. So if you like to gamble, go and gamble, you know? I mean, but it has nothing to do with Bitcoin. There's not in the same universe.
And I would add to that, you know, in 2011 to 2014, 15, there were the first of the altcoins really emerging. Litecoin used to be considered a, you know, test net for Bitcoin. Perhaps back then there were some, it was understandable that people were launching altcoins because it, you know, like I said, we were all like walking around in the dark trying to feel around what Bitcoin was. And we still didn't understand the whole process of this consensus algorithm. Not until 2017 and the hard fork was it a major light bulb moment where instantaneous knowledge was transmitted across the world that why Bitcoin worked, why the consensus algorithm was needed. You know, so back in 2011, 2012, 13, 14, you know, people were still trying to think, oh, you know, this is interesting. Bitcoin is this and that. But we want smart contracts. And, you know, Bitcoin was always had that ability, but it's like such a slow development because security of the protocol and the network is priority. So we're glad now that Bitcoin stayed slow and steady. But at those early altcoins, you know, they were trying to do something because they didn't understand that Bitcoin could already do it. And anything coming up now is again, kind of a dishonest version of those early altcoins, because I don't think, you know, Bitcoin's not going to be able to do anything that, you know, Bitcoin could do anything that any of these other things try to say that they're all about that.
And that's the unique thing about Bitcoin. It just takes longer with each cycle. So now that we've gone through our halving event, people are like, okay, why isn't Bitcoin at 20K? Well, because it doesn't happen overnight. It takes time for those supply and demand economics to play out. Towards that target of the stock to flow going up to 100K in 2021, there's an important thing to note here. If we take a look back at the previous cycle, we should have reached around, I'm trying to remember the actual level off the top of my head right now. I think it was around like 9 to 11,000 for Bitcoin at that range. And you can see how actually the chart was delayed from when it should have hit, like right here. It was delayed and it actually took a while to reach there. So I think that even though the fundamental value of Bitcoin around that time period under the current stock to flow model should be 100K, and I do believe we're going to reach 100K, I think it's going to happen a little bit later than most people. My target range is for November or December of 2022. So nearly going in towards 2023. So we've got a couple of years until we get there. And the reason I do that is I like to keep my estimates as conservative as possible. But also when we get to that range of 100K, I'm not going to just sell everything. We know that Bitcoin, you know, I think last time I was thinking the top was going to be 10,000. And it went to 20,000 back in 2017. Mm. So it's a matter of being prepared to take profits around that range, because that is the exponential zone. That's where maximum profit taking capacity is. But at the same time, you don't want to miss out if it goes to 150,000, 200,000. So you can use tools like stops for taking profits, all kinds of different mechanisms in that case that I'll be looking to use probably around that time. But I trade those broader cycles again. That's the key thing. Not trying to trade too much in between outside of maybe allocating between Bitcoin and altcoins during this time period.
Wow, really, really nice. And I think that's a key point. A lot of people expect the stock to flow ratio to react exactly the same as it's been reacting. But as you said, each cycle is starting to extend itself more and more. And that makes a lot of sense because, you know, it can't peak as fast, you know, or maybe in the short time frames that it did in the initial halving. So it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, I want to drill that point and stuff. There's been technically people debate on like how many cycles we've had. The three last major uptrends we've had in crypto all the way back since really when markets were formulated back in late 2010, early 2011, we've had basically three previous major cycles. And each of them has expanded by that 11 to 13 month period. So it's a very key thing to keep in mind in that case, is that that's the consistency we've seen so far. You can roughly estimate it's about a year, right? 12 months, right? If you want to meet in the middle. So each cycle is going to be expanding a year here. And I think we'll start to see a pretty big divergence where in the long term, the halving model will begin to be a tad bit priced in. People will understand what it is as Bitcoin becomes more of an investment class asset. And then really after that, it's going to be the demand shocks when there's issues with the traditional banking system, when central banks are printing excessive amounts of liquidity. If we really reach one day where the US dollar hits hyperinflation, that kind of doomsday libertarian kind of thesis of why Bitcoin would have been valuable in the first place, you know, who knows? It could happen, right? Things like that can happen in the real world. The world is becoming increasingly volatile. So I think that's where Bitcoin really shines. And that's what's going to carry out the next cycles over the long term.
What you do is you give every human being on the planet access to every financial network on the planet. I can do a bank transfer in any country in the world. Just yesterday, I paid for a photo shoot. I'm designing my own clothes as well. In Estonia, I don't have an Estonian bank account, but I sold some Bitcoin to a guy over there and he paid her. And I do it here too, to pay my rent here in London. I don't have an English bank account yet. And my bank account in New York, Bank of America, won't let me do a wire internationally unless I'm physically in the branch. This is a big shot American bank, Bank of America, and they're that ghetto, believe that. Where do? I go into Paxful, I sell some Bitcoin, boom, the deal is done. Isn't that beautiful? I can access any bank account in the world or any financial network in the world. I was in China. I was charged. I wanted to charge my phone at a kiosk. They took Alipay or WeChat. I didn't have Alipay or WeChat account. Went into Paxful, sold some Bitcoin. The guy sent it for me. I gave him the QR code. Done. Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah, it's amazing.
That is so beautiful because it makes people rich. Like without that, people would not have a way. That's like the poor are used to paying more for financial services because the alternatives, they won't be able to access that financial service at all or make that payment at all. But here we can create a free market out of that. And then the free market dictates, okay? Some things will cost a lot, some things will cost less, especially as the market grows. It's beautiful. That's how we create wealth. That's that easy. It's that easy. And for me, that was the breakthrough. All we need to do is just let people use the money that they have, and that's it. We'll all get wealthy. Wow.